We'll again hear from you during the open forum. Now we go to our second discussion. Engineer Philip A. Varela, Assistant Secretary, Infrastructure Management, Department of Information and Communications Technology. ASEC Varela is a seasoned professional electronics engineer and a CAN engineer with over 34 years of experience in telecommunications or ICT. Appointed in August 2022, he supervises the broadband ng masa program, including free Wi-Fi for all and the National Broadband Program. He also oversees the Infrastructure Management Bureau, PUBT-ICT, and chairs the DICT Bids and Awards Committee. ASEC Varela represents the ICT in various interagency committees, such as NEDA Infocom and the Philippine Space Council. He chaired Sub-Planning Committee on Digital Infrastructure in the Philippines, PDP 23 to 28, and leads the CIO Forum. Previously, he directed the Infrastructure Management Bureau and held executive positions managing ICT projects and policies. ASEC Varela has received numerous awards for his service and holds a master's degree in industrial engineering and management, and a bachelor's in electronics and communications engineering from the Polytechnic University of the Philippines. You now have the virtual floor, ASEC Varela.
Thank you for your kind introduction. And I would like to thank PIDS, particularly the authors, Monette Serafica, Chris Francisco, and Quincel Oben, for the research they made on making broadband universal, review of Philippine policies and strategies. And also, I would like to thank PIDS for holding this webinar in this year's National ICT Month. In general, I actually like the arrangement of the report, starting from some facts on ICT and broadband and providing comments afterwards. Similarly, my comments and inputs will follow the research paper. And the presentation made by the authors. I have taken note of the references made, especially the National ICT Household Survey, which was done in 2019, which is actually being updated right now. The paper from FCC related to the identification of broadband as to the whether it is downstream and upstream, and how what would be the good throughput, no, under these two streams, and given the speeds, no, for various applications, 10 to 100 Mbps should be targeted, as it would allow access to substantial services and application using telemedicine, telecommuting, teleeducation, and broadcast video and other video services. We have also taken note of the Household Broadband Guide from USFCC, in that it gives us a reference on the requirement of the household users classified into basic, medium, and advanced, with corresponding bandwidth throughputs. I agree that the choice of technology significantly affects the cost of broadband deployment. If I may, just to comment that the sentence on LEO is misplaced and may not be accurate. LEOs can provide sufficient capacity and coverage, although it remains to be more costly than the other technologies. May I also clarify that should LEO satellite operators fail to launch more satellites while they aggressively onboard users in their systems, capacity issue will arise. And I agree with the rest of the research on the use of different technologies on depending on their uses, whether it's 3G, 4G, 5G, fixed wireless broadband, and fiber. 4G deployment is good, especially in rural areas, and 5G deployment can continue also, especially in targeted areas that require more capacity, either because of multiple users or the broadband application or service require it. I also note that the impact of broadband, as stated in the study, would increase GDP growth, no? To as much as 1.5%. And an updated study on this economic impact of broadband has to be made, either as part of the NBP 2.0 or a separate study. The DICT is now processing inputs from various stakeholders for the drafting and finalization of NBP 2.0 or the second version of the National Broadband Plan. We have noted the distinction of universal access, or UA, to universal service, or US, and the move of other countries to combine the two to make it universal access and service. And I agree that countries should aim for both UA and US. In rural areas, it will be difficult to aim for US because of cost and affordability of the services, and the phase approach per area should be pursued from universal access to universal service. I also noticed that on table three, if you can include the Wi-Fi access points in the availability part of the universal access. I hope you can also include something on internet access, since most, if not all, descriptors of universal access and universal service are based on telephone-based services. I agree that internet is now an essential tool for inclusive and sustainable development, and government intervention through a proactive national broadband strategy should be pursued. Deployment should be pursued to increase coverage. Adoption should be intensified to increase service uptake. And that usage also will be delivered and received, and the benefits of these different applications such as e-commerce, telehealth, and teleeducation can be absorbed by our people. The initial government intervention, like supply side promotion and competition regulation, they are very much noted, and we can also work for universalization to ensure widespread coverage and use. As a government enabler, lowering barriers to entry and removing restrictions to supply services. And promote content is they are important in getting our people use broadband services. We need to reduce cost of the network, expand the network, and reduce regulatory burden. And we need to accelerate the network rollout. The government continues to provide ICT and broadband services in the not so profitable areas, even rural areas. And I'm glad that Table 4 considers a more recent study on these things. On supply side approaches, I agree with the continuation of government, whether national or local, And the private sector partnership, no? To deploy connectivity in rural areas. Infrastructure sharing, both passive and active, can reduce costs up to 70%. As mentioned in the study, the government can also participate in the infrastructure sharing initiative because it has digital infrastructure that can be shared. Cross-sector sharing on passive infrastructure can really result in large cost savings. The ICT has actually has been meeting with the Department of Public Works and Highways and in coming up with a guidelines, with some guidelines on the development of this cross-sector sharing. This will include infrastructure for electricity, telecommunications, water, and sewerage. Government will have to be clear on what type of infrastructure will be shared and who will be the concerned operators. I also like the discussions presented in the ownership models. Funding models and ownership models are related and intertwined. In our consultations, we came across different models, such as purely funded by the LGU. And so because there are some LGUs that are actually putting up some digital infrastructure in their own locality. There are some LGUs that are partnering with the private sector in rolling out this digital infrastructure. Some LGUs are also looking at the national government to partner with them and partner with another entity, you know, from the private sector to help in the development of the digital infrastructure. Of course, the national government agencies also partner with other with the private sector. There are some projects that are funded purely by national government agencies, while there are also projects that are funded by the private sector, either unilaterally or in partnership with another telecom companies or even national non-government organizations. On spectrum pricing and sharing, I agree that spectrum should be awarded to those who will use it effectively and efficiently, and that it would benefit the society. Spectrum pricing should be clear and allow or encourage the deployment of more broadband infrastructure. Spectrum management policy framework should be formulated to have fair competition and supports adaptability to technological advancements, maximizes efficient use of limited spectrum resource. Spectrum sharing is something that can also help us use the spectrum more efficiently. This should be part of the spectrum management policy framework. On demand side approaches, I agree with the suggestions such as subsidies, demand aggregation, education and training, and enhancing privacy and security to improve public confidence in broadband service, as well as provide relevant content and applications such as on education, public health, media, entertainment, and government services. On subsidies, we have taken note of the affordable connectivity program of USA, and we are actually thinking of a similar project under the Free Public Internet Access Program, wherein poor and qualified families in the unserved areas can be provided access to broadband services, in addition to other demand-side approaches and supply-side approaches such as infrastructure sharing and other approaches. We have also taken note of the study's review of various Universal Access Fund and Universal Service Fund models, by UNSCAP, which found out that effectiveness of such funds have been limited due to various reasons and challenges. It also noted that lack of data hinders ineffective management of public investment projects and development of rural broadband initiatives. Moreover, national and provincial level funding and partnership with independent policy research institutions and universities may address this issue. I also took note that we have actually reached the target of less than 2% of GNI per capita for mobile service. While affordability and mobile network performance remains to be a challenge for the Philippines to both service and handset. I'm glad that you have referred to the Philippine Development Plan targets and status. And many regions have underperformed as presented in Table 9. I'm also, well, I'm. It's interesting to note that the research made some comparisons between a LEO satellite provider and a cell site, no? The bandwidth throughput that can be provided by cell sites. Just perhaps to point some corrections, I think the NTP being referred in the research is referring just to one portion of the NTP, which is NTP 1-1 in Luzon, because there's also NTP 1-2 in Visayas and NTP 1-3 for Mindanao. And RTDP has phase 3, yes, but it's actually called phase C, you know, and that is to support the implementation of the previous phases of RTDP. The municipal telephone project has private sector implementers, you know, and MTPO has only implemented in provinces not identified by these telecom companies. And TSBs was also implemented by the private sector, but not as interested, no, compared to MTP. I was flagged, no, that I have to stop. Can I continue? Or should I just mention my other inputs during the Q&A?
Yes, you can add to your manifestations during the Q&A. Probably you can close your reactions very quickly. Said Barilla.
Yeah. I agree with a lot of the things that that the research presented. Perhaps in addition, the NBP and the free Wi-Fi programs have to be integrated and supported by government. Right now, under the free Wi-Fi, we were able to provide the internet services to 6,041 LGUs and NGAs. We have provided 3,404 schools, no, with internet. That's public, elementary, and high schools. In addition to 1,071 SUCs and local government unit owned and controlled universities and colleges, plus 23 libraries. On health side, we have provided digital connectivity to 1,455 hospitals and rural health units. We have also established government emergency communication systems with our move sets, that's mobile mobile operation vehicle for emergency, which actually has mobile command centers, dispatch vehicles that would go to the incident command post, and the motorcycle to go to ground zero. And that the DBM also would can also help us in providing additional plantilla positions to the ICT, you know, for connectivity. Time is up. Yeah, thank you very much. I'll just mention some other things later on. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I said very well.